space in the head is off the dark. From change.
like a tourist in the city you were born, then it's time to go. And define your destination. There's so many different places to call home. 'Cause when you find yourself the villain in the story you've written, it's plain to see. Sometimes the best intentions are in need of redemption. Would you agree? If so, please show me.
Tracing this cold heart, and now I'm all out of thread. And I don't wanna die here. Keep chasing echoes in my mind, babe, it's a fine line, and I'm so far over it. And I know it. Beneath it all, I'm so broken. Cut me out, cut it open. I can't do it anymore. Can't do it. I don't pay any mind to the dew upon the vine. Does that mean that it's not there if I can see it all? Though the morning light burn away all the fog the night creates, there'll still be a trace of our love.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Lake Forest Church. My name is Harrison. It's great to be here with you guys. Let's stand to our feet together this morning as we prepare to worship our God together. It's great to be here with you. Let's sing. sing this together.
Created from dust, you came and you lived among us. You took on our frame, you walked in our pain, and now you're taking us higher. You stepped into time, down your life to save us. You took all our shame, on the cross it was laid, and now you're taking us higher. We go from glory to glory to glory. We'll never be the same, we'll never be the same. We go from glory.
This morning, will you pray with me? God, we are so thankful that as we follow you, that you lead us closer and closer to you, that you show us more of yourself, that we're not just left, but that you bring us from glory to glory as we know who you are, as we know the kind of God that you are and who we are in you. So I pray that we would walk in that this morning. We are here for you. It is in Jesus' name we pray these things together. Amen. You guys can have a seat.
Well, good morning and welcome again to Lake Forest Church. If we haven't met yet, my name is Susan Arrington and I'm on staff here in communications. So good to be with you here this morning. Hope you enjoyed your extra hour of sleep today. When you came in today, you received one of these cards, the chance inside for you to let us know that you're here today. You can learn a little bit more about our strategy of discovering, belonging, sharing, and going as followers of Christ here at Lake Forest. Most importantly, though, there's space on the back that you can let us know how we can join you in prayer this week. We're a community that prays, and we know that God is listening, so write down whatever you're carrying on your heart today for yourself or someone in your life. In just a little bit, we're going to pass around a jeans pocket, and you can tear off that portion of the card and drop it in there. That's also when those of us who call Lake Forest our home can give back to God and worship with our tithes and offerings. That's just one of the five ways you can give here at LFC and expand what we're able to do as a church in our community and around the world. I'll take just a few minutes to let you know about some things happening at Lake Forest beyond Sunday morning. I'm going to do them in order of how they're happening and go through them quick, but there's more information on our website, lakeforest.org. So tonight, this evening, there's a new men's Bible study kicking off. It's called A Man and His Work. It's being led by Doug Poppin, one of our ministry partners. It's a great first step into Bible study, maybe, for guys. If you've never taken one before, love for you to just come and check it out tonight. It begins at 6 o'clock. Doug has worked in corporate America. He knows what it's like to be in jobs that you love, jobs that don't seem like a fit. He knows like what it's like to be out of work. He has a great perspective on the whole series of work. So he'd love to see you there tonight. This Friday night, we have an awesome event coming up for families. It's called Phases and Fall Fest. So what's happening is in this room, parents are invited to come. Pastor Mike will be here and also a local psychologist. We'll be talking through the different phases of parenting and how you can best serve your kids as they grow. We're talking about from babies to the early teenage years. While that's happening, the kids will be outside participating in supervised fall fest activities. And then after that, everyone goes back on the lawn around bonfires to have some s'mores and just hang out as a community. So we'd love to see you there. Invite neighbors and friends if they'd like to come as well. You can learn more in RSVP at lakeforest.org/events. If you were here with us last week, you got to hear a little bit from Jeff Hathcock, who is the Barstool pastor. Well, he and his wife Mandy are entering into a new season of their ministry. They talk about God in bars and restaurants in Greater Charlotte. They're transitioning to actually becoming the Barstool Church. So there's a lunch happening after the second service next week for you to just come learn a little bit more about that, and mostly just encourage Jeff and Mandy as they enter into this new chapter of their ministry. RSVP for that also at lakeforest.org/events. And finally, as we enter in November and the holiday season is approaching us, it's the most wonderful time of the year for many of us, but it's also a really tough time of year for those of us who've experienced loss or in going through grief right now. That's why our Grief Share community is offering a special gathering next Sunday afternoon. It's called Surviving the Holidays. It's where you can come and just be surrounded and people that understand what you're going through and have practical tips and just support to get you through the holiday season. Again, more info is at lakeforest.org/events. We're beginning our new series today called So What Do You Do? For some of us, work feels like a four-letter word. Some of us start to feel like jittery even on Sunday mornings when we think about what's to come. But that doesn't have to be that way. There's meaning in our work, and God has a meaning for us in our work. And that's what Pastor Mike is going to be talking with us today and what we'll be talking about through the rest of November. Let's continue.
Will you stand with us this morning? As we worship, we receive God's love for us, and we express our love to Him. And that's what these songs are about. And we see, often you hear Jesus say that we should knock and the door will be open to us. So my encouragement to you during these times as we worship together this morning is that you would knock, and wherever you're at, if you're in a place of saying, man, I cannot wait to see what God is going to do, that's awesome. And if you're in a place where you're just saying, God, I just need to hear something, anything, knock and let Him open the door this morning. Let's worship Him together.
Be the mountain where I'm found. You're never gonna let me down.
God, we're thankful. We're thankful for your love for us, even to death on a cross, even while we were yet in sin. You loved us without conditions. And you called us to yourself. God, may we be more like you. May we walk in truth. May we walk in holiness. That as we come close to you, we'll be changed. We pray these things in Jesus' name.
Good morning, I'm Mike Moses, lead pastor here, and it's great to see you today. An interesting reflection I just had this moment. There are always more people in the 9:30 service, so first of all, thank you for being here. Please don't switch. It's really important that we have some space in that service. Second of all, in spite of that fact, the last several weeks, you guys out-sing the fire out of that group. In praise and worship, yeah. I don't know what it is about you guys at this 11:05 service, but there's just a lot of passionate worshipers of God who are willing to be verbal and kind of worship God with our full heart, full throat, regardless of circumstance, regardless of musical talent. And I like that about you. That is our vision for our worship through singing, so I just want to say well done. That's kind of cool. I just thought of that. We're starting a new series today. Maybe, how many of you saw the movie WALL-E? Okay, good number, bunch of you. WALL-E portrayed one of your greatest dreams came true. Work was abolished, and everybody spends a lot more time in recliners. Recline back in their lazy boys. This was the dream. No work, no school ever again. Now, if there were actually some middle schoolers or high schoolers in now, I thought I might have heard an amen when I just said that. In the movie WALL-E, middle schoolers, high schoolers, I gotta have you. Imagine, okay, imagine somebody declares no school ever again, and you would say amen. So let's try that. Just the middle schoolers, the high schoolers, we've never had a teen-only amen in here. In this movie, they declared no work and no school ever again.
Amen.
You are the man or the woman over there, whichever you are, I'm not sure. Awesome. So this is what they do, but now humans have managed to trash the earth, but we advance so much, this is in the movie WALL-E, so much technologically that humans live in high-tech space stations enjoying a carefree and most importantly, work-free existence. Now the humans in these space stations in the movie, they're waited on hand and foot by robots attending to their every whim and desire. As a result, humans have become pampered, self-indulgent, bored couch potatoes. In the movie, adult humans, as you can see on screen, now look like giant babies with soft faces, soft bodies, and stubby, weak arms and legs. It's this gross, deforming result of humans doing nothing but cruising around on cushy, padded, lazy boy recliners, eyes fixed on video screens. Now, as a movie watcher, like the big idea we've all dreamed, man, what if I woke up today and work was abolished? Wouldn't that be awesome? Like, that's awesome. But as a moviegoer, that high-tech space station with human couch potatoes is anything but appealing. The creators of WALL-E were exploring what it means to be human. And this is a question that every civilization throughout history, every tribe, every person has always explored throughout time. What does it mean to be human? And in this movie, they're exploring this, and we're reminded in a funny cartoon way. Do-nothing couch potato existence is repulsive, and it's actually dehumanizing. Why? Because as human beings, we were actually created to work. And that's the start of our new series today, What Do You Do? Whether it's in an office or a restaurant, a classroom, or if your work is in a living room surrounded by diapers and toys, your work, student, if you go to school, your work is school. Your work is your answer to that question. So what do? And although you spend a majority of your hours at work or school weekly, sometimes it seems like in Christian circles or in church, we don't pay much attention to those hours, leaving the impression that to be a faithful follower of Jesus, that God only cares about your religious activity time. And the rest of that is irrelevant to your faith. And people like me have actually given that impression. And we, in this series, we actually want to turn it around and look at what God's Word says is a robust view of, and yes, I'll use the word theology, of work from the Scriptures. And we're really asking the question today, am I made to work? Like, are you going to make me? Do I have to work? Like, am I made to be a student in school? Do I have to? Or am I made to work? This is what part of what I'm created to do. And for Christians, those of us in the room and worshiping online, hello to you all. This is basically how to follow Jesus in my work life. And if you're not yet a Christian or you're exploring the Christian faith, then this series will be a snapshot of who God is and can be for you in the way you spend the majority of your hours every week. This series will be a little bit more than other sermon series of mine that's sort of like a box set. We'll be building, and we were hoping to build a complete biblical theology, almost complete, of work. And so I really encourage you to kind of be here for everyone because you're a worker. I'm going to be here for all of them, and I'm looking forward to it. Now, if we could get a little more house lights, because guess who showed up this morning to bring the word? Reverend Dr. Professor Moses. And I'm speaking more to your understanding than I am to your heart. I didn't cry one time in the first service, okay? So that's the kind of sermon this is, for our biblical understanding to inform our work. And so you may want to take some notes today. Let's go. From the very beginning of the Bible. What's the Bible? It's God's story and our story and where they intersect. The Bible includes principles and commands and wisdom and history, but the whole thing is a story. It's the intersection of God, creation, and humanity, where it's been, where it's headed, and where it winds up. That's the Bible. And at the beginning of this story, of our story intersecting with God's, we see that the one true God is not a couch potato God, nor did he create a couch potato world. Here's the very opening of the Bible, the Genesis storyline. Genesis 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's in the beginning of us and of the known universe, not the beginning of God. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. And here we're immediately introduced to a God as a thoughtful and creative worker. Can you see this? Can you put that overlay on it? God is working, he's creating, he's doing, and the Spirit of God is hovering over the waters. He's the activator part of the Godhead. And so God's infinite creativity, God's omnipotence, God's omnipresence, his omniscience are unleashed in tactile engagement in his good creation, doing stuff, making stuff. It's as theological as I can say it. As God's work of creation unfolds, okay, this is what God is doing at the beginning of the story. What are we doing? Well, humankind, the crown of creation, emerges on the literary landscape right here in chapter 1. And God the Creator places a stamp on human beings. And it's a unique stamp relative to the rest of creation. Genesis 1, 26 to 28, here's where you and me first show up. Then God said, let us make humankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, including koala bears, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created humankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. God, what's the first thing God did to humankind? Blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, increase in number. Use your Bible words to interpret that, but you know what that means. Fill the earth and subdue it. rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. The Genesis writer, whom Jewish tradition tells us is Moses, wants us to grasp the unique place of human beings in creation. And this repeated use of the word image, did you see it come up a few times? Image, in God's image, tells us of the importance of this concept for understanding what does it mean to be human. The question every culture, every civilization, every individual, every teenager is always asking, what is a human being? And we observe this the way image becomes of God becomes foundational in two important ways here. First, humans are designed by God to exercise leadership over creation. This is the divine delegation. When you delegate at work, at home, hey, dude, you're in charge of taking out the trash. When you delegate anything, that's in the image of God, who's the first delegator. And he delegated leadership. The word rule over is the Hebrew root word for all leadership functions in the Old Testament in ancient Hebrew. He's like, go take leadership over. All that stuff, that big fuzzy ball of dirt spinning through the cosmos. You take leadership over that. That's the first bit. That's a divinely delegated stewardship leadership role. And then God's image bearers are to uniquely reflect who God is. We're like an image bearer means, like, I'm me, but a big part of me is to reflect whose image I'm in. So we're to mirror and reflect the glory, the excellence of the triune God. An image bearer is designed to reflect the image of another. To be all that's uniquely you, as that God made each human being, just like each creature, unique and special. But through your unique specialness, you as a prism reflect the image of the one who made you in a unique way. We asked a question in this regard on Facebook this week on the Kidtropolis page. Hey, what kid at Lake Forest Church Huntersville, is the most spitting image of their mom or dad? And here's what we got. Thank you, guys. You sent in a bunch of pictures. We didn't get them all up here. And these are fun. So look at these pictures and see if you pick out who you think is the most clearly the spitting image of mom or dad. We won't comment on what this one family means in the lower right, that the parent and child are thing one and thing two. That's kind of weird. Okay, do you know who you think is the most spitting image right here? Okay, here's who the staff in a very scientific poll determined was the most spitting image. Aww. That's Tiffany and Milo Bratina, and aren't they so cute? That Milo is just the spitting image of mom there. God created you to reflect the spitting image of who he is as your heavenly father and your loving creator to the world, to the people closest to you, and even back to yourself. Now, we're not little gods, nor will we ever become God, because God is person and we are individual persons and they will always remain distinct. But as human beings, we're created to reflect our Heavenly Father, to be a spitting image. And so here's where we start this series. At a foundational level, the image of God in you reveals God is a creator and a worker. God is not some cosmic do-nothing deity or couch potato divinity. The Christian life, by the way, growing in any part of the Christian life is so much about continuing to know who our Heavenly Father is, both by knowledge, what we learn from God on our own and with others studying the Scriptures, and experience when we relate to Him personally in prayer and dynamic encounter. And when we continue to look more closely at who our Heavenly Father is, then we know ourselves more authentically as a result, instead of other people telling us lies about ourselves, because you're made in that good God's image. I don't know if you continue to follow the TV show This Is Us, but this whole season this fall is like the kids of Jack, they just want to know more about their dad. They want to know more about their dad's story because they understand it informs their story and why they are who they are, and helps them move forward. Have you noticed that theme this season? And that's what a Christian is to do. I want to know more about my dad, my Heavenly Father, because his story is the foundation of mine, and his image is who I am to reflect, and that's most truly me when I'm reflecting that. So this is why we come to worship him together, and we study his word together, alone and in groups. Have you ever seen this bumper sticker or had it on your car? I owe, so off to work I go. Anyway, this is the cynical Dilbert-esque answer to why do I work? And paying the bills that comes to us each month is no small thing, man. Sometimes it's all we can do to pay the bills. But here's my question. Is economic transaction or wealth building? Some of you are like, Mike, you used the word wealth today in the sermon. That's not really a word I think of when I look at my paycheck. But let's just say money. Is monetary transaction the reason why we work foundationally? Well, Scripture tells us the most bedrock answer to this question, why do I work, is that you were made, you were created with work in mind. That's why. Being made in God's image, we've been designed to work, to be fellow workers with God, to be an image bearer of God, and most of you believe and own this, that yes, I'm made in the image of God. It's to be a worker. In our work, we are made or created to show off God's excellence, to display God's creativity, to shine with his glory to the world in our work. And we work because we bear the image of the one who is the original worker and creator. Now, God could have placed Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden and made it just like the world of humans in WALL-E. He'd be like, hey man, dude, here's Garden of Eden. Pick out your lazy boy recliner with the three cup holders and the built-in TV remote and the massage button, right? You can massage your pinky toe even. You can massage any little toe that you want. This is so you have such an awesome recliner. Here you go. This is life. Did God do that? No. He reveals his original intent before sin or destruction came in the world and said, here's the earth. It's not perfect, but it's good. Take it somewhere. Lead it. Rule over. Go do some stuff, like develop it. I can't wait to see what you come up with. That is what God did, rather than the lazy boy recliner, couch potato version of humanity. Because God himself is a worker, and because we are his image bearers, we're designed to reflect God, who in and through and by our work. And so the work you're called to do every day, the stuff that you're like, man, he keeps saying the word work, and I keep stressing out because of what I'm facing tomorrow. But if you can take the stress out part of it off for a second, in every little bit of what you do, I mean the what, I don't just mean the big idea of it, the what, every little bit of it is an important part of our image-bearing nature and stewardship of leadership on this earth. And in this sense, we're not only human beings, we're also human doings. We've been created to contribute to God's good world. And so first and foremost, I want us to get this through our brain. Work is not about economic exchange. First and foremost, it's not about a pathway to the American dream. First and foremost, foundationally, the reason we work is that we were made for God-honoring creativity and contribution. Tom Nelson, in a book that is highly informing this sermon series, there are two or three, I'll give you the book list later in the series, but Tom Nelson says, our work, whatever it is, whether we're paid for it or not, is our specific human contribution to God's ongoing creation and to the common good. That's our starting definition. Because work is an integral aspect of being a human being, which means work is an essential aspect of loving God first, and it means work is a vital part of loving our neighbor as ourself. I mean work as an intrinsic thing, not just the relational part of it. Now let's move on to Genesis chapter 2. If you're a Bible scholar, you may know Genesis chapter 1 sets up the creation story. Genesis chapter 2, the author backs up and re-reflects on what he just wrote. It's a second creation account reflecting on different aspects of it. And we'll learn here at the beginning of chapter 2, prior to God forming man and woman and breathing life into them, before sin enters the world, the Genesis writer raises a tension regarding incompleteness, right in the middle of God creating. We don't know which days this was between, but in Genesis chapter 2, verse 5, we read this. Now no shrub had yet appeared on the earth, and no plant had yet sprung up. for the Lord God had not sent rain, and there was no one to what? Work the ground. Humans have not been put on planet Earth yet, and the word work just came up. No one to work the ground. In other words, God created humans not only to delight in Him and love other people, but He created humans to make an interactive contribution to His creation. Do you see this? Let's put that back up on screen real quick. The earth was created to desire and to wait for and to be completed by dynamic interaction with God's image bearers who were yet to arrive on the planet. Do you see that there's this integral, symbiotic deal in God's mind and His plan and in actuality today that we play out for better and worse between the material planet, its creatures, and human beings? So from Genesis 2, we see this. The earth itself was shaped in or was created in order to be cultivated and shaped by humankind. You get this? But before the fall into sin, God desired and designed there would be harmonious human cooperation with the rest of creation, and that it would be our work that would tend to it and take it to its full potentiality. For example, an apple tree growing in the wild in the forest, it'll make some apples. An apple tree tended to by Johnny Appleseed, the farmer, produces bushels and bushels more. The earth was created with potentiality that will never be realized unless humans take up our leadership capacity and we work it. This is beautiful, and this is how we're made. And so not only would human beings, the crown of creation, have joyful intimacy with God, you're created for that. It says they walked with God in the cool of the day. Not only would we be given the other people to love, it says male and female He made them. We have people to love. But also, we're given the joyful privilege of contributing to the work of God in this good world and taking it somewhere to cultivate it. Well, as Genesis chapter 2 continues, we get a further picture of a human being, you and me, as a worker. We observe work as it was originally designed to be before sin and death entered the world. And Genesis 2:15 is really our theme verse for this morning. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. There's that word again. We were made to work and take care of it. Notice this. Whose initiative is this? Did the human being go, I mean, I got a good idea? No, the Lord God takes the initiative and places humanity in a place with a particular task in mind. And so the emphasis is not on personal human choice, but divine initiative and divine calling. See, already in Genesis here, we see that vocation, what our calling to be and do in life, is not something that we ultimately choose for ourselves. We choose the details of it and this pathway or that, but the fact that we have a calling to be a worker and to take it somewhere is God's initiative, not ours. And so this is really important to know. God is not only your creator. We're very used to acknowledging God as creator. Like today, when we walk out of here, I should be finished about 2 o'clock. We walk out of here, and we see the beautiful fall sky. We feel the breeze against our cheek, and we look at the color of the leaves. We're going to thank God, our creator. Right? Well, almost everybody in here will naturally do it. But have you ever thought God is also your caller? He's called you to vocation. The image of God in you is to thank Him for creation and all in your life and to listen to Him as the primary caller of your life. Starting all the way in 6th, 7th grade, as you're learning, man, I hate math, but I really like that history stuff. Or I really like that after-school club, like theater stuff. All the way to every age of our life, as you hone down, this is the stuff I'm good at. This is the stuff I like. These are the things I cannot stand on this earth, and I'm going to give my life to combat it and correct it. All those things about you, you know what they are? They are echoes of the great caller. He's calling you by the way He's made you, what He's made you to care about. Starting at a young age, in middle school, that's an echo, and you know what that is? That's your divine caller, and you're hearing echoes, and He's speaking to you through your being, through skills that you gain, knowledge you've had, experiences God's given to you, even the bad ones, the things you've learned from them, and your divine call. He's not just your creator who you go, hey, thanks, fall is awesome. He's your caller. Hey, thanks. You've put me together as this way, and it's turned into this kind of work and vocation, and I want to bring the best of me to bear on that. As I listen to you as my caller and my creator. Here in the Genesis narrative, we're given two bedrock truths regarding human work and vocation. And I want to pass along to you the thought of one of the primary books in this field by a guy named Crouch. Forget his first name. And it's this: we are made to work with the perspective of a steward through culture making. So a vital aspect of this stewardship, not just being created, but being called to work. Stewarding this is the essential work, not only of tending things and making things, but cultivating and creating culture. And so Andy Crouch, in his book called On Culture Making, helps us to be sure we stay out of two ditches that are typical for Bible-believing Christians. One of those ditches that he deconstructs is that as Christians, we're like, man, God only cares about our soul and our spirit and being saved and going to heaven when you die. God cares about those stuff, but if that's the only thing you think he cares about, we get off in the ditch of, so therefore, we hate culture. We withdraw from it, and your job is not important. Just go ahead and do that, but that doesn't connect to God. It's just your religious stuff, and one day, you just wait around until Jesus comes back. So retreat from culture is one error in the Christian community. A different but similar error is the overt triumphalism of Christianity over culture. We're supposed to take it over and beat down those who don't agree with us, and we're going to take it over. And he says, no. You're made to be a culture maker along with God on this earth that reflects his glory to everyone. And let's talk about this for a minute. He suggests that Christians adopt a stewardship posture. You're called to lead and take it somewhere. Anchor it in cultivation and creation. And again, he calls it culture making. Would you say this with me? Culture making. Would you repeat that one more time? Culture making. So we are made to work with the perspective of a steward through culture making. This generally involves people who are cultivators or creators. Okay, right now. If you're an executive in charge of a bunch of stuff and people and money, if you are a sales clerk at a convenience store, or if you check people out any kind of place, the school cafeteria, if you are a salesperson thinking about your quotas right this minute, sorry I mentioned that, if you are a business owner, if you are a homemaker, if you're a high school, college, middle school student, or a PhD candidate, if you're a social worker, if you're a medical professional, if you're a public servant keeping the peace, law, and order, if you're a social worker, if you're a veterinarian, whatever you are, what do you do? Get in your head, this is what I do. So when people say, so what do you do? Just get that in your head. If you're a school principal in the house over there. Now, I want you to pay attention. I want you to think. Now, cycle that through you and these two categories we get from Genesis 2:15. Here we go. Which one are you? Cultivators, Andy Crouch says, are people who tend and nourish what is best in human culture, who do the hard, painstaking work to preserve the best of what people before us have done. These are the two words describing work in Genesis 2. Are you more of a cultivator? The cultivator, so take the first human beings that were put in a garden. The cultivator is the person like, hey, this garden has potential. Hey, there's some weeds over there. They pull the weeds. They bring a little more order. They snip and they prune. And they do the things that, to take what is there and find the full potential out of it. Think of a homemaker. You're bringing the full potential out of this raw material of these little tiny human beings. And you're tending and cultivating so that the fruitfulness is at its maximum potential. Apply that to any job. You maybe tend toward more of a cultivator. Other people tend more to be a creator. People who dare to think and do something that's never been thought or done before. Something that makes the world more welcoming and thrilling and brilliant and beautiful. Maybe you're an artist. Maybe you're an eighth grader and you doodle and you've created some characters nobody's ever seen before and you're not sure if you want to show it to anybody. That might mean you're a creator. Maybe you're an entrepreneur and you're like, man, nobody's had this idea. I got to put this together and I'm going to put this and grab that technology and these right skill sets of people. We're going to take this into a company that's never existed before and it's going places. You're more of a creator. You could do that in a business unit inside of a company. I don't know what it is. So just for a second, pretend like you could actually commune with the Holy Spirit in your spirit, because you can. And I want you, every age, think about which one. Just say, hey, Holy Spirit, did you make me more of a cultivator or a creator in my calling and work in life? Just talk to the Holy Spirit for a second and determine which one you lean more toward. Crouch makes an important point that whether we're cultivators or creators or a mixture of both, that in our work, our creative work is it's variegated, it's broad, it's far-reaching. We don't only make things or fix things. We're involved in creating and cultivating human culture itself, and it honors God, by the way, that collectively, humans, whether or not we acknowledge God or have a relationship with Him, but the image of God in us, we collectively tend and create moving culture to new places. That's an interpretive key to all of human history. This is what we've been doing on planet Earth, playing out the image of God in us, whether we acknowledge Him or not, taking, create culture, making, and we're doing it today. And your job is a feeds into a part of that. And that honors God. So one more time, can you say culture making? Yeah, the actual actions of your work or study or homemaking create to making culture. Now, I'm going to take it one step further, Professor Dr. Moses, and theologians call this in Genesis 1 and 2 the cultural mandate. And so I really want you to hear this. So if you could say cultural mandate with me. Cultural mandate. This is what God has given to us in Genesis 2:15. And so this language of work as cultivation and creation in Genesis 2:15, it's embedded in this Hebrew word, avodah. I'm going to show it to you. It's behind the English translation to cultivate or tend or keep. Avodah. Now, check this out. Those of you who are Bible scholars in the house, this is remarkable to me. The Hebrew word avodah is translated in various ways throughout the Old Testament. It's rendered as work in many instances, yet other times it's translated and the situational meaning is worship. And it first occurs here in Genesis 2:15. Avodah is used to describe the back-breaking hard work of God's people making bricks in Egypt in Exodus chapter 1. Avodah is the work of the skilled carpenters building the tabernacle in the desert in Exodus 35. Avodah is the work of the craftsmanship using linen to create tapestries in 1 Chronicles 4 for the temple. Avodah is in the context of Solomon dedicating the temple, using the word avodah as he instructs the priests and the Levites regarding their work of leading worship in the one of the one true God. And so whether it's making bricks, skilled carpentry, crafting linen, or leading others in corporate praise and worship, the Old Testament writers present a seamless understanding of work and worship. You may want to, with your phone, take a screenshot of those references if you're wanting to take that further. Because a common thread of meaning emerges where work and worship are inextricably linked. The various usages of this Hebrew word found first in Hebrews 2:15 tells us God's original desire and God's original design is that our work and our worship would be a seamless way of living. See, so often we think of worship as something we do on what day? Sunday, yeah. And we think of work, it starts on what day? Monday. So does school. However, this compartmentalized dichotomy between work and worship is not at all how God designed it for your life and for mine. In fact, again, this is from Tom Nelson. God designed work to have both a vertical and a horizontal dimension. We work to the glory of God and for the furtherance of the common good through culture making. From those who collect our garbage weekly so that we can live in a clean environment, to those who serve food at a counter, to those who are running our banking system from the top corner office of the downtown skyscrapers. It's the same for all of us. On Sunday, we say we go to worship, and on Monday, we say we go to work. But our language reveals we have not fully ingested Genesis 1 and 2 and into our understanding of what it means to be a human being before God. That God designed work to be an act of worship. And so we don't want to miss this. Angie and I were privileged to tour London in England this summer. Unfortunately, we were there in the crazy heat wave, so it felt like we were in South Florida. But we toured, and one of our favorite experiences was Westminster Abbey. Here's a picture of us there with me trying to suck my gut in. That was the heaviest I've ever been in my life, was that moment on our trip, the last day of June. Well, I loved Westminster Abbey. It was one of my highlights, and we were there for Sunday evening worship. It was actually an organ recital as worship music. It was just beautiful. It was so inspiring, particularly the architectural work of art. And it reminded me of a story that people tell of the building of Westminster Abbey. It's probably apocryphal, but it's a great story. And somebody walked up to three stonemasons who were breaking up rocks and shaping them. Goes up to the first stonemason and goes, while they're building Westminster Cathedral, "Hey, what are you doing?" And the first stonemason says, "I'm breaking up rocks." He goes to the next stonemason on the other side of the pile of rocks. "Hey, man, what are you doing?" He said, "I'm making a living." And then he went to the third stonemason and said, "Hey, what are you doing?" He said, "I'm building a cathedral for God and God's people." What a difference a perspective on our work makes. I wonder how you see what you do when you work. Are you the first guy and you're like, "Man, it's breaking up rocks. It's breaking my back. It's killing, I got aches and pain." Do you just see the task itself? Work is that, no lie. Do you see it primarily as, you know, you got the task, but it's the paycheck? Work is that. It's to provide sustenance and wealth building for individuals, for families, for communities and nations. It is that. Are you able to go the next round and go, "It's avodah. It's work as worship. I am creating culture in my little tiny way as best I can, and it's building a cathedral." The entire human community is meant to be a cathedral of continuous worship of the living God who gave us our work to see it as high and holy, even while we're breaking up rocks. The early Presbyterians, hey, I'm going to lean into our Presbyterian tradition for a minute. They had a phrase for this way of viewing our work, living and working before an audience of one. That if our Heavenly Father watches over every sparrow, His loving, caring, watchful eye is on us in all that we say and do, whatever we're doing, including our work, because it's what we do a majority of our time. And doing our work before an audience of one changes what we do and how we do it. And living with this mindset helps us connect our faith with our work, because we live before the same audience for the same purposes on Monday as we do on Sunday at worship. The British Christian writer Dorothy Sayers writes this: "The church's approach to a carpenter is usually confined to moral instruction and church attendance. By the way, this series is my version of repenting to you for buying into this. Hey, be good in your relationship with Jesus. Read your Bible. Do that stuff." But that's about all she's saying, typically, we've said to anyone about their work. She goes on, and this is who I hope we will be. "What the church should be telling them is this: the very first demand that your religion makes upon you when it comes to your work is that he should make good tables." Stop for a second. Make good tables. What your work or your studies or your homemaking, what is in the phrase that he should blank? Make good what? Just for a second, say what that is. As retirees, you know what that is too. Might have to do with your grandkids. What is it that you should make good blank? What is that in your work, your calling, your work right now? She's not saying that the church offering moral instruction and good worship is unimportant. It's very important, and to talk about other parts of our life. But it's important that in a Christ-honoring local church that we equip one another with the importance that we teach one another, and even the language we use in our men's and women's groups, community groups, remix, the language we're using is, hey, whatever your work is, that's an act of worship. It's avodah. Sayers continues with this one final phrase. Let the church remember this, that every maker and worker is called to serve God in his profession or trade, not outside of it. The only Christian work is good work, well done. Would you say aloud with me that last phrase? The only Christian work is good work, well done. Maybe you grew up as church boy or church girl like me, and you're familiar with like a wrong view of work is this common phrase in the church world. Oh, Christian work is when you enter as a missionary or a church staff or a parachurch deal. And that is a distorted view of avodah, the image of God in each person, the calling of God for each person to work and worship as one thing while you create culture. It's hard to imagine how our understanding of work, your daily sense of meaning and importance and purpose, and the quality of our work could change if we would truly believe the cultural mandate in Genesis 2:15, live before an audience of one, and embrace the truth. The only good Christian work is good work, well done. Dorothy Sayers is not making something up here. That it's good work well done to the glory of God, to the good of others, and to our satisfaction. The Apostle Paul wrote almost exactly this to some of the first Christians in Colossians 3:23. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for who? The Lord. Avodah. Work as worship. Not for human masters, since you know you'll receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. Like one day, the cathedral will be fully, the kingdom of God will be everything. It's the Lord Christ you are serving or working for. Okay, let's finish. One of my spiritual gifts is ESP, extrasensory perception. I can read people's minds. And here's what you're thinking. Number one, Panthers kickoff is at 1. Number two, Mike, this is really interesting, and you really were Professor Dr. Moses today. Okay, got it. And I'm at least a little bit inspired as to the purpose of work. And I would like to believe I am made for it. And that 8 or more hours a day really is an important way of me just worshiping God and being an awesome follower of Jesus. But you don't know the difficulty of my work. You don't know the pressures of my workplace. You don't know my anger and frustration as a stay-at-home parent that I have with these children who are gifts from God. But I get angry. You don't know about that struggle. You don't know about how mind-numbingly boring my job can be, or what it feels like to be a student in school, and it doesn't feel like God made me to be a successful book learner, but I'm pressed into that mold. Mike, you don't know what that's like, or how difficult or demeaning my boss can be. Mike, you don't know what it's like to be a person of color in a majority other culture and try to make your way against headwinds. Mike, and you know I don't know, but I know exactly what you're describing. What all of us knows is that chapter 3 of Genesis continues the story. And sin came into this world, and it has affected and twisted every part of us and every part of the world, including our work. And so we're going to take a clear-eyed, sober look at the effects of the fall in our work as people and in our vocations next Sunday, and I hope you won't miss it. In the end, remember I said, the more we look at our Heavenly Father, the more we learn who we are. He's a creative worker, therefore we are too. But most clearly, it's the more we look at Jesus, the more we fall in love with our God. He's the invisible God made visible. And one time, some people were trying to slow him down, and he said, hey, I haven't finished. I still have work to do. He used the word work. I got a job to do. What was Jesus' work? On the cross, he said, it is finished. What was his job? Jesus' work had you in mind personally, directly, individually. His work was no less than to reconcile, put back together the whole earth, its creatures and its people, with the holy good God whom it had rebelled against, back into right relationship now and forever. And so he lived a perfect sinless life. His work on the breaking up rocks was to accept a willful torturing death on the cross. The wages that he earned for this work was to atone for every sin, every bit of death, every bit of shame, every bit of suffering. That's the payment he received. And the way it was avodah, as worship, was to offer to every human being who says, yes, I want that payment to be on my behalf. Would you please transfer his paycheck into my account and make me right and righteous with God again, to live in relationship with him, working as worship in this life and living forever in his kingdom. Just please say yes. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you're so good. Thank you. Thank you for the self-knowledge that you don't leave us to question our meaning and our place in this world. You've spoken to us through your word, and we hear it. We take it up for our work to be worship this week. And for anyone here who's ready to put their faith in Jesus Christ, you just right now, you say, Jesus, I now give all that I understand and know of me to all that I understand and know of you. Please forgive me for my sin. I now take your resurrection on my behalf for your Holy Spirit to live in me, and I will follow you, including in my work. And we pray this in Jesus' name, amen. Friends, I have homework. Before I dismiss you, let's put this on the screen. You can take a screenshot. I'm going to put it on Lake Forest Facebook this afternoon. Your homework, your application, is to discuss these four questions with someone, a friend, a family member, or someone at work this week. That's your homework, and actually come up with answers for you, okay? So, now may the grace, mercy, peace of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be yours. Go in peace. Amen. Prayer team is out the door to the right. They'd love to pray with you for any reason.